What's cracking, big dogs? Welcome back to the channel. It's your boy Nick. Big dogs got to eat fantasy football. Getting into another team outlook. Continuing into the NFC North. We've done the Packers. We've done Chi-Town. We're getting into Minnesota Vikings. This was actually a more entertaining one for me to do. I like the Vikings. I like the little setup they got going on here. And I think it's going to be an interesting video for y'all. Remember, if you liked the video, make sure you scroll down a little bit, give it that thumbs up, and subscribe to the channel if you're new and you found this informational and if it helped you, because I'll be doing all 32 teams. A lot of them are already up, so if you want to see a certain team or a certain player, just type in the name in my search box. Also, quick plug, Big Dogs Gotta Eat dad hats are available for sale on the website, which is in the description, bdgeat.com/shop. So if you need a hot dad hat for the summer, we got you covered here. Also, Fantasy Jocks has the number one best fantasy football league gear in the industry. I can promise you that. This is not a sponsored video. I do have an affiliate link, which you can click down below. Affiliate link's not the same thing as sponsorship, so I don't want to hear that. This is a draft board kit, really good with all the player labels. They do championship belts, trophies, rings, all that kind of stuff. So if you need anything for your league, go click that affiliate link below and it will take you right to the site. You can check it out from there. Really cool stuff if you're looking to take your league to the next level. As always, we'd like to thank our sponsors, Monster, for getting us through this video, although they are not my sponsor, but it'd be cool if they were. Oh man, the quarterbacks. Teddy Bridgewater, the saddest story ever told. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Sam Bradford took over the team as the quarterback in Minnesota. So, last year, Sam Bradford set the NFL record for the highest completion percentage in a single season ever. 71.6%. Probably because he was dead last in average depth of target. 6.6. Somewhere Alex Smith is sitting there watching this video with a big smile on his face, so proud of Bradford. So despite his efficiency, Bradford ended up as quarterback 23 in fantasy last year. Threw for just 20 touchdowns on 552 attempts, so it was one touchdown every 27 and a half throws. Not good. It's no secret that the Vikings O-line is shitty. I mean, I guess it's a secret to the Vikings front office because they don't want to do anything about it. But that's, I don't know, that's their game plan. Bradford took a ton of hits last year. He was sacked 38 times, took the seventh most hits, 107 in the NFL. They went out and signed Latavius Murray. They drafted Dalvin Cook. They didn't have a lot of help on the O-line. So what that says to me is they want to be more run heavy. I mean, you weren't drafting Bradford anyways, but if you were in a quarterback two, if you were in a two QB league, it's very possible that you were looking at him as a later round draft pick. His ceiling, if it wasn't already low enough, got even a little lower in my opinion, but he's one of those quarterbacks in the late 22 to 28 rankings range. So we move over to his weapons, right? Cordarrelle Patterson, Charles Johnson are both out of the picture, which leaves 107 of their targets up for grabs to a wide receiver group that consists of Stefon Diggs, Adam Thielen, Laquon Treadwell, and newly signed Michael Floyd. Stefon Diggs, man, is one of the more interesting arguments. It was last year and is going to be again this year. His talent flashes. Like, it makes incredible plays, has these crazy breakout games. He just can't seem to put it all together. He's just 23 years old, so there's plenty of time for that. Just 23. The guy Matt Harmon, who does reception perception, basically breaks down a certain player by looking at a high percentage of their routes. He'll look at just one player, he'll break down the film and see how he did against press coverage, man coverage, zone coverage, all this kind of stuff. And Stefon Diggs is consistently one of his favorite route runners, and that's a big part of being a success in the NFL and fantasy football, is that Stefon Diggs is such a good route runner, and that's why he has these breakout games. And he had 84 catches last year, over 900 yards. It's good to see, but it's just not, you know, being in Minnesota is not an ideal situation for any wide receiver. As I talked about, Bradford's number throws a touchdown every 27 and a half attempts. Stefon Diggs only had 3 touchdowns last year, so despite 83 catches, he still finished as wide receiver 30 in PPR leagues, and way worse, wide receiver 43 in standard leagues. He also has a little bit of injury risk to him. He's played in 13 of 16 games in each of the last 2 years, so he's missed 6 games the last two. Limited by groin, knee, hip issues, so those are not things that you like to see. It's not like freak accidents, not like a finger was broken or something like that. All lower body. So what I will say is the switch from Teddy Bridgewater to Sam Bradford definitely hurt Stefon Diggs and his development, or at least his ceiling as a fantasy receiver. His yards per catch dropped from 13.8 with Teddy to 10.8 with Sam Bradford. In standard leagues, despite improving his catch total by 32 catches from 2015 to 2016 and receiving yardage by 182 yards, Diggs averaged only 0.9 standard fantasy points per game more in 2016 than he did in 2015. He needs those touchdown numbers if he wants to, if he's ever going to be elite, if he's going to take that next step, if he's going to surpass his ADP, he needs the touchdown totals, which I'm just not sure are there. He's not involved near the end zone, so Bradford had 31 attempts inside the opponent's 10-yard line. Not a crazy number, but he was 12th in the NFL in that. Diggs only saw 3 of those 31 targets. As your wide receiver 1, you need to be more involved down there. I know he's small, he's a smaller guy, but you see Antonio Brown, you see Odell Beckham absolutely soaking up those targets. And compared to guys like Kyle Rudolph and Adam Thielen, they combined to see half of them. They had 15 of the 31 targets. So, you know, there's no doubt that Stefon Diggs has that greatness that he flashes. He had a 9 catches, 182 yards game, 13 catches for 164 yards. He's making crazy catches. He caught at least 6 passes in 7 of 13 games. So, a good PPR play, obviously, way better than standard leagues. As it stands right now, he's going around pick 47 as wide receiver 25. And I just can't get behind that. There are guys like, let me see. Oh, Ty Montgomery, Martavis Bryant, Larry Fitzgerald, Julian Edelman, Jameson Crowder, Willie Snead, all guys going after him that I would take before him. Like I said, he flashes the talent. I just don't see the overall upside. I don't think he can maintain any of that kind of level of play with the low touchdown total for a full year. Great dynasty player, obviously, like I said, worth a lot in that type of league because he is only 25 years old. You don't know if Teddy Bridgewater is going to come back this year, next year. His numbers are a lot better with Bridgewater. He's just a guy I'm probably going to be off of in a lot of leagues this year, especially at his current price. So playing opposite Stefon Diggs is Adam Thielen. Big breakout year last year. 2 unproductive years with the Vikings prior to that. But he caught 69 balls, 967 receiving yards, 5 touchdowns, finished as wide receiver 25. He had one game that was just absolutely incredible. 12 catches, 206 yards, and 2 touchdowns at Green Bay. What I want to caution people who think Thielen is another breakout candidate this year, 1, Green Bay was probably the worst pass defense in the league last year. 2, that performance was sandwiched in between a 0 catch and a 1 catch performance, so he had that. And 3, obviously that monster game accounted for about 25% of his fantasy total production on the year. So obviously Minnesota likes the kid a lot. He's just 26. They're building around a really nice young wide receiver core. They locked him up through 2020 and gave him a nice extension for about $20 million. So they have a lot of confidence in him. Obviously they want him to be part of the build. He will be the wide receiver too, despite Laquon Treadwell coming back, despite Michael Floyd. But I don't really see him anything more than a mid-floor, mid-ceiling wide receiver 3-ish in fantasy. Fortunately, he's going at a really good price right now. He's getting picked at 112 overall, around wide receiver 45. So you're getting a pretty good deal on him. He's well-sized, so 6'2", 200 pounds, 5 targets inside the 10-yard line. Not crazy, but he's a little bit involved down there, which is good, seeing that his size. It's hard to get behind the wide receivers on this team because, 1, they have a decent amount of weapons. They'll spread the ball around, and 2, they don't throw for a lot of scores, and they have, you know, this upgraded running game. So who knows what their offense is going to be. It's probably going to be a lot more run-heavy now. Thielen's going late in the draft, so you can get him, you know, for a good value. If I'm going to take either him or Diggs, it's definitely going to be Thielen for me. All right, so I'm going to move over to the wide three position, which doesn't hold a lot of value fantasy-wise in the Vikings offense, obviously. It's going to be Laquon Treadwell for the most part. He's not going to outplay Thielen or Diggs in terms of the depth chart. He will probably be the number 3. He was the first-round pick for them in 2016. Disastrous rookie year, dealing with injuries all season, caught 1 pass. What I think the impact of it is, usually a rookie season like that doesn't really translate into a good sophomore season. It's almost like he needs another year to develop now, and the third year could be like his breakout. So I don't see a lot of value there. What I will say is Treadwell, the player that he is, right? He's 6'2", very long, lanky-ish, goes up, makes those crazy catches, can play with the fade ball in the end zone, something that this offense didn't have. This actually hurts Kyle Rudolph a little bit. Kyle Rudolph had a 32.4% red zone target share in this offense. That is like bound for regression. Think of anything he takes away from Rudolph's ceiling. I think he's a player with really good ball skills that can go up and get it, and I think they'll design plays in the red zone for him for that purpose. So take away from Rudolph, of course. Definitely a much better dynasty option. Again, he's super young, was just drafted in 2016. He's going right now as wide receiver 76 over like the 200th pick overall, so you don't have to spend any capital on him. If you're in like a keeper league, you want late round pick. I still don't think he's a great pick because Thielen's locked up for a while. Stefon Diggs is very young. They're probably going to lock him up too. So I don't see the crazy amount of upside. He could be just a role player in this offense for years to come. And they went out and signed Michael Floyd, previously of the Patriots. He's already dealing with like legal issues and shit, so there's a lot going on there. But the fact that they brought Michael Floyd in, you know, they added more depth to it, and now it's someone that Floyd will battle with Treadwell for, I guess, plays. And they're going to keep him on the roster at least for now through the offseason to see what he's got left, because he was once a very talented wide receiver. He's going down a bad path right now. So what I'll leave you with wide receiver-wise is Stefon Diggs. I think he's overvalued. Great talent, but I don't think he's going to be able to put it together with Minnesota. Adam Thielen, undervalued. A good floor player who's got some upside, but a lot of his production came in one big game last year, so don't be fooled by that. Luckily, he's going late in the draft, so you can get him. I would take him over Diggs on a value play. Treadwell and Floyd, it's just not a valuable position, the wide receiver three position in Minnesota fantasy-wise, so I'm staying away from them as well. Brings us to Kyle Rudolph, who I've touched on. Career receiving year for him. Finished as tight end 2 in fantasy behind Travis Kelce. He caught 83 balls, 840 yards, 7 touchdowns, so really good numbers. Now, while they're impressive, obviously the tight end position as a whole was really down last year. If you took those numbers back to 2015, he wouldn't have finished as tight end 2. He would have finished as tight end 8. So I don't want those numbers to skew you and make you feel like he needs to be a top 5 option this year. He's definitely a key piece to that offense, especially in the red zone. Like I said, 32.4% target share in the red zone on that team. He had 10 of a possible 31 targets inside the 10. Good number, good share of that. Having Laquon Treadwell back, having a guy like Michael Floyd maybe in the red zone is going to take away a few of those targets. I also think they're going to go a little more run heavy, obviously, with Dalvin Cook now and Latavius Murray in the mix. Murray will be that like goal line guy, so rather than throw it on the 1 or 2 yard line, you know, they'll stuff it in there with Latavius Murray, something they couldn't really do last year. So right now Rudolph's going as tight end 9, 77 overall. I can get behind a tight end 9 draft position. That's okay with me. That's probably, he'll be in my ranking somewhere from like 8 to 11. All right, so the running back situation, a lot of messiness here. I'll tell you straight up, this is what I think is going to happen. I think Dalvin Cook's talent is real. I think Latavius Murray's talent is not real. And I think that's how it plays itself out. Dalvin Cook becomes a starter, early down work, sprinkles in pass catching work, and a lot of goal line work. Latavius Murray struggled in an offensive line, 4.0 yards per carry, behind Oakland's best offensive line, run blocking line in the league, arguably. Other running backs in that offense, 5.6 yards per carry. So it was clearly Murray was the problem there. I so believe in Dalvin Cook's talent. He was incredible at Florida State. Knack for the end zone. Just so many intangibles. Just really incredible to watch on film. I know his combine wasn't great. Cook is really, really good. And I'll tell you what, he reminds me, he's 5'10", 210. Reminds me of a very similar running back that we saw at Florida State also a couple of years prior to Dalvin Cook. Plays for the Atlanta Falcons now. His name is Devonta Freeman. Very similar style of play. Very. So don't be shocked when those comparisons start rolling out. Jerick McKinnon has proven, despite his spark score 4 years ago that people are still hooked up on, that he can't be the workhorse. He's not going to be the workhorse. He's barely getting touches as it is. Latavius Murray's come out. He said that he's missed most of the offseason training program already. Him and Dalvin Cook are obviously both new to the team, so that's given Cook a step up on Murray already. So I think he wins the starting job outright. Head coach Mike Zimmer's come out and said this kid has a chance to be very special. Went on to talk about a couple of plays that he's made so far. So, you know, they're raving about him in camp. Do have to be realistic, though. The Minnesota offensive line is really bad. So whoever's carrying the ball is going to struggle. I think Cook realistically gets about 14 to 16 touches a game. I think he gets a little bit of passing work. I think maybe he ends up with 30 to 35 catches. And I think he gets a little bit of the goal line work. I think Murray will be the short yardage guy. He'll probably get a lot of goal line work because he was successful at that in Oakland. And McKinnon is more just change of pace, breather kind of back that'll sprinkle in pass catching and he'll sprinkle in some early rushes. But I don't see McKinnon being used often. I think Cook has incredible upside here. I think his upside is capped, obviously, by the O-line and by the crowdedness in the backfield. But I think the crowdedness back there is going to be, it's going to play into a lot of people's analysis more than it should. So he's currently going off the board at like pick 52 to 55 as running back 20. And I'm more than happy to roll the dice there on Cook, given what I think he could be. To look at the running backs going after him, Tevin Coleman, I'll easily take Cook there. Amir Abdullah, that's a very good argument. I'd probably take Abdullah. But then you have CJ Anderson, Mark Ingram, cool with that. So I think Dalvin Cook's priced very accordingly where he should be. It is going to be an RB2 in PPR. And I think Murray has some standalone value as the goal line back, and will probably get somewhere from 8 to 10 touches considering the contract he got. So he has some standard value for sure. Probably more of like an RB3, low-end RB3 at that. But nonetheless, he's going really late off the board. I think into the hundreds probably. Yeah, like 135. Yeah, it's kind of crazy now. He's at 135. I mean, there's value in that pick, but other than that, like I said, I love Cook. I believe in the talent. I believe that he wins that starting outright position, and he reminds me a lot of Devonta Freeman. So that's my thoughts on the Minnesota Vikings for 2017. I hope you enjoyed. If you did, please scroll down a little bit. Just hit that thumbs up for your boy. Again, if you want that dad hat, very minimal, just the Big Dog's Gotta Eat logo. You need a fresh one for the summer. It's a nice brown leather band. Go check out the website, which I'll link in the description. And if you need Fantasy Jocks, the affiliate link is down below for your boy. Subscribe if you're new, all that other jazz. Go follow us on the Twitter, all that good stuff. Peace out, homies. I'll see y'all next time. The heart is a blue, shoots up through the stony ground. There's no